Good morning and welcome to Orchard Park Presbyterian Church. We're glad you're here and we welcome you. We invite you to come to our drive-through communion this morning, beginning at 10:45 and ending at noon today, and all are welcome. And now let us gather together and worship God. Our call to worship this morning is from Psalm 107. Thanksgiving for deliverance from many troubles. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the world say so, those he redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and the west, from the north and the south. Some wandered in the desert wastes, finding no way to an inhabited town. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted within them. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. And he led them by a straight way until they reached an inhabited town. He turns rivers into deserts, springs of water into thirsty ground, a fruitful land with salty waste because of the wickedness of its inhabitants. He turns deserts into pools of water and parched land into springs of water. And there he lets the hungry live, and they establish a town to live in. They sow fields and plant vineyards and get a fruitful yield. Come, let us worship God.
Table for everyone, Lord, in the altar and Confident in God's endless love and mercy, let us now confess our sin to God. Let us pray. Lord, forgive us when we so easily turn our backs on you, when we choose not to help in times of need, when we utter words of anger and bitterness as ways to relate to one another. Heal our hearts and our wounded spirits. Lift us from the depths of our anguish into the light of your love, that we may serve you faithfully. When the darkness becomes oppressive and we cling to our fears, O Lord, forgive us. Open our hearts and release us from all those things which block us from your love. Lord, hear now our silent confession. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen. God's brilliant love bursts through the oppressive darkness to heal our hearts and make us new. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Praise God.
Let us now pass the peace of Christ with those who are worshiping with us in body or in spirit.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I'd like to invite all of the children to come forward for a children's message. Hi, everybody. I would like to talk to you today about something I bet you've never thought about when you thought about coming to church. It's a little thing that when I thought about it longer, I realized is really important, and that is oil. Did you know that we use oil in this church every Sunday? In our gospel reading today, we have a story about bridesmaids who were getting ready for a bridegroom to come to a wedding. And some of the bridesmaids were ready for oil in their lamps so that their fires would burn, and other people were not prepared. Now, we don't use oil in our lamps anymore. We use electricity. But a long time ago, they would use something like this. And inside, there would be this little container, and they would put oil in here, and this would be used to keep fire going. In our sanctuary, we have a flame that is always lit. It is always on, and it's up in the corner of our sanctuary, and I bet you've noticed it before, but you've probably wondered what it is or why it's there. And if you notice and if you look carefully, you will see that there is a little flame. That flame is supposed to represent the eternal life of Christ. That life of Christ never goes out. It is always with us. It goes on and on forever and ever. On Sunday mornings, you've also probably noticed that our sanctuary, on our table, we have candles. And these candles keep going through oil. So every week, somebody pours oil into these candles, and then the flame keeps going because of the oil. There's a funny story that happened here at Orchard Park a couple years ago. Somebody brought the wrong oil, and the oil was for outside fires instead of inside fires. And on Christmas Eve, we had smoke all through the sanctuary. And that is a memory and a story that we will always remember. The moral or the lesson in the story is to keep your oil going, to have enough oil or enough faith or enough a relationship with God that even in dark times, when you feel low or sad or lonely or scared, that you have enough oil to remember that Jesus is with you, that he loves you, and that you carry the light of Christ. The light of Christ never goes out. It's something you carry with you everywhere you go. So keep shining your light. Let us pray. Almighty God, help us to be the light in the world. Help us to have enough oil in our hearts that we may keep burning for you in all we do. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
A reading from the prophet Amos. Alas for you who desire the day of the Lord. Why do you want the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light, as if someone fled from a lion and was met by a bear, or someone entered a house and leaned a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I hate, I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And your offerings of well-being of your fatted animals, I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream.
A gospel reading this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, the first 13 verses. Hear and receive God's word to you today. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take any oil with them. The wise, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom, come to meet him." Then all the virgins woke and trimmed their lamps. The foolish one said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourself." But while they were there, away to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others came. "Sir, sir," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "I tell you the truth, I do not know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Give us oil for our lamps, Almighty God. Give us enough rest, enough faith, enough hope, enough love, and enough grace to sustain us all through the day and all through the night while we wait for you. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, Almighty God. Amen. Halloween has come to an end, and by all accounts, all decorations, merchandise, and commercials has moved rapidly from one holiday to the next. And by next, I mean Christmas. We have had multiple meetings already here at Orchard Park planning for Advent and Christmas about what we will do, how we will offer it, and what it will look like in this COVID climate. There is a feeling that we are already late for Christmas, and we better stop shopping now lest we miss a purchase. We can easily leapfrog from October to December and forget this little space in between here in November, these 4 weeks of Thanksgiving, of the end of autumn, and of the turning to winter. In anticipation of Advent, the next 3 weeks of our lectionary focuses on the chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew 25. Matthew 25 is divided into three sections, each part building on the other, all directed toward a warning its readers about Judgment Day. Now, some of you may have grown up in a church that preached on judgment maybe even every Sunday. You may have sat in Sunday school classes where you were told to be ready for Judgment Day, to be sure you were on the good side of things. One preacher once preached to a congregation, "Jesus is coming on a train, and when he stops at your stop, will you have your ticket ready?" Others of us were raised in churches where we recognized that Jesus would come again. We testified to that in the Apostles' Creed and in the Nicene Creed, and we believed that Jesus would come in glory. But the teaching was not to spend so much time waiting and looking for signs and thinking about him coming, but rather to build the kingdom of God on earth today, to obey Jesus' commandment, and to proclaim the good news. Preaching Judgment Day was shelved for another day that just never came. Regardless of what we were taught about Judgment Day, the message that Jesus brings to us and his disciples are the same. He begins with a rather uncomfortable and strange parable that takes place around a celebration in the form of a wedding, and the bridegroom, aka Jesus, is late. Very, very late. And the disciples are waiting, and those are the bridesmaids, and they're waiting, and they're waiting, and they're waiting. We know some things about waiting, don't we? We know we don't like it, we know we aren't skilled at it, and we know that our culture takes pride in not having to wait. If you have to wait, it's bad customer service. If you are kept waiting, you feel offended. Waiting is boring, it's a waste of time, and it's unproductive. So the bridesmaids are in that anxious and frustrating state of waiting. They have done and redone their hair 100 times. They have applied and reapplied their makeup. They have gotten out the cards and they have played every game they can think of to pass the time. Some of them are prepared with oil for their lamps in case he comes at night, and some of them are not. Their resources are running low, so half of them have to leave to get some more. And when they come back, the bridegroom has arrived and it's too late. And those who were without oil are told by the bridegroom that he does not know them, so they can't come in. Now, what is this all about? Doesn't Jesus preach sharing? Yes. Doesn't Jesus preach grace? Yes. Doesn't Jesus say, "Knock and the door will be open unto you"? Yes. So why didn't the other bridesmaids share? And why didn't Jesus rebuke them for not sharing? And why didn't he let them in when they came knocking? I think it's all about the oil. It's all about the energy that keeps your light going. That oil comes only with the regular, ongoing discipline of spiritual preparation. The oil is the work of prayer. It's the study, it's the song, it's giving, it's offering hospitality, it's worship. It's the work of noticing every day that God is in your midst. That is the oil. The work we can be tempted to let slip away in the face of constant tyranny of the now. It's about the energy that keeps your faith on fire. It's all about the perseverance to keep going even in the darkest of times. That oil is your steadfast faithfulness. In Hebrew, it's hesed. No doubt there are times when we can feel our oil running low and we start feeling more darkness than light. Is Jesus there? Was he ever there? What if he doesn't care? What if he's not coming? We can lose our light and we can burn out. There is always something else, someone else demanding our attention. And once that supply dwindles from our inattention and our lamps end up empty and our own light flickers out, we are unable to light the way for us or for anyone else. Now, I don't think we get in this low oil condition only because we stay way too busy to pay adequate attention to our spiritual lives. Certainly, the stress of life and schedules, the caretaking of elderly parents or children or both can leave us feeling pretty empty. But there are also other external factors that are draining our oil supply. Even listing them on paper makes me feel low. A contentious election, a relentless news cycle, a merciless virus, a divided country, a fearful future. Anyone else feeling a little low on oil? Anyone else feeling a little tired of waiting? Anyone else just wanting everything to get better? Anyone else feeling a little low on fuel? Anyone else praying the prayer, "Come, Lord Jesus"? When the burned out bridesmaids come back and ask to re-enter the wedding party, I do not think that Jesus answers saying, "I do not know you." I think he is responding by saying, "I do not know you." In his yearning, I hear Jesus acknowledging a truth that deep down we also know. When we have not tended to our own oil supply, when we have gotten so caught up in anxiety and fear and violence and the exhaustion of our world that we have stopped spending time in regular prayer, in scripture, in worship, in service, then we have to confess that we really do not know Jesus. We're kind of faking it. Jesus as well knows that we are not prepared and that we are not ready. And so there is a delay. Jesus is simply stating a fact. You and I have not hung out. You haven't come beside me and you haven't talked to me. You haven't spent any time with me in my word or responded to my teachings or served my people. You see, simply, we don't have a relationship. There's an accountability here on our part. One writer puts it this way: knowing Jesus is one thing. Jesus Christ knowing you is altogether another thing. being identified by Jesus Christ as his own, then you know him, and he also knows you. And when you know him and he knows you, you know. The thing that keeps me awake at night is this constant nagging of wonder and worry if children and young adults today know Jesus Christ. Not a watered-down, plastic, easily obtainable Jesus. Not the kind you can just go pick up at the corner store on a way to a party, but rather a real, authentic relationship that takes time and dedication to cultivate. Kenta Creasy Dean is a professor for youth and young adults at Princeton Seminary, and she argues that this faith comes about when individuals cultivate an understanding of God as a loving, powerful, and active presence in the world, when they are engaged in spiritually and relationally significant ways with a faith community. When they have discerned a divinely appointed purpose for their lives, and when they can articulate a hopeful future for themselves and for the world. It is our task as Jesus Christ's people to develop this faith, this fuel, this oil to light their lamps and our lamps. We are to work continually so that when Christ comes, we can shine this light of faith. So often we tell ourselves that we are exercising our faith when we do good things in the world. And though this is often a practical result of faith, I believe today's parable about the kingdom of heaven tells us that the fundamental nature of faith in action is something very different. It is not simply about being nice. It's not about writing a check or just doing something good. It's not cheap. It's deeper than that. Now, stay with me here. Preacher Harvey Kim makes this argument. If being nice and doing nice things were the essence of the kingdom of heaven, then the wise bridesmaids would have shared their oil, and the bridegroom would have opened the door to those he did not recognize. But instead, the story from Matthew teaches us that devotion to the bridegroom, to Jesus Christ, who is coming to be united with us again, causes us to prepare the fuel of faith, the oil for our lamps. It is when these lamps are lit, when our light shines, that Jesus recognizes us, sees our face, and welcomes us into his fellowship. Our role is to cast light, our light, into the world. Every Christmas Eve here at Orchard Park, there is this moment when we pass the light of Christ through the congregation. And people light their individual candles from the flame that is passed among them. When I get the privilege of standing up here as the music washes over us and the bulbs above us dim and the light grows in the sanctuary, one of my favorite things, my favorite blessings, is the ability to be able to recognize each face in the light, way across the sanctuary. Faces that get lost in the crowd with the sanctuary lights fully on. These are highlighted, and I can see them clearly on account of the light held in front of them. At the end of it all, there is a sea of faces, so many of them distinct and recognizable, glowing from lamps held in front of them. And by these lights, miraculously, a once dark sanctuary is awash with light and more spirit-filled on that night than on any most bright morning. In the same way, it is my fervent prayer that this church, our community, might continue to spread the light of Jesus Christ, one person at a time, through our community and through our world. The night cannot last forever. The night will not last forever. I assure you that the bridegroom will come. Do not put your lamps away in a closet, but have them on hand and lit. Prepare for that extra supply of oil, because you can never have too much of it. Never tire to do good, even if the world says it's foolish and pointless to do so. Stay awake. Stay awake. Because you do not know either the day or the hour. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Another day in paradise, as you stumble to your bed, give anything to silence. There's voices ringing in your head. You thought you could find happiness just over that green hill. You thought you would be satisfied, but you never will learn to be still. You're like sheep without a shepherd. We don't know how to be alone, so we wander around this desert, wind up following the wrong God's home. The flock cries out for another, and they keep answering that bell. One more starry-eyed Messiah meets a violent farewell. Learn to be still. Learn to be still. Now the flowers in your garden, they don't smell so sweet, so sweet. Maybe you've forgotten the heaven lying at your. Learn to be still. be still.
As we come to a time of prayer together this morning, let us remember all those in our church family with ongoing needs and concerns. Let us unite our hearts in prayer. Lord, we are a stubborn and impatient people. We always want to know what the schedule is. We would like to know when we need to have all the oil for our lamps. Help us to learn and to trust in you, in your Holy Spirit, to lead us day by day and moment by moment, that we might be ready to go where you send us. Lord, hear our prayer. Holy God, we ask you to heal our hearts and our nation. Help us to reach across our divisions to work for justice and reconciliation. Lord, hear our prayer. We lift up to you those who are sick, lonely, afraid, or grieving. Help us feel empowered to reach out with the love of Christ and to be present with all who are hurting. Lord, hear our prayer. We ask your blessings on those around the world whose lives have been torn apart by natural disasters, by wildfires, hurricanes, typhoons and earthquakes. Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty God, as we gather around your holy table this day, remind us that we are all members of the one body of Christ, and we are called to proclaim faithfully your love to all generations. All these things we pray as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God's blessings are endless. Let our gratitude also be endless as we return to God our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Go in peace. May the road rise up to greet you. May the wind be at your back and the sun shine warm upon your face and the rains fall soft upon your fields. May the light of Christ lead you where you need to go and guide you every day. Until we meet again, amen.